So I think everyone have gone through the, like, what is the topic for today? It is structure streaming with Kafka. So I call this talk as a deeper look into the integration of Kafka and Spark. So we also have a code hosted in GitHub. So if anyone wants to follow the code, you can go to this link and download the code. So I just want a basic Kafka server to run the examples if you are interested. So this is the agenda for today. Before starting with Kafka, I want to give a brief introduction about data collection and data ingestion. So this is like a very basic concept, but I haven't seen many people talking about this more as we talk more about data processing or machine learning, those kind of stuff. So this is something I want to give an introduction, and also what are the tools available in the open source where people can go and use. Start the session. So how many of you are into streaming? So are you guys using dish streams or structure streams? Dish streams. So how many of you are familiar with structure streaming in general? So is it just learning, or you guys use it in projects? Okay, no sound. Okay, so how many of you know, like, what is a data collection? So most of the people, like if you say data engineers, they don't focus more on data collection, I feel. But it's very important to have these two pieces happening efficiently so that your whole data pipeline will work in a proper way. So what is data collection? It is nothing but your collecting the data from the input source and making sure you don't lose the data whatever generated at the input source. And there can be various different type of workloads even for data collection, similar to what we have for data processing. So I want to discriminate these workloads as batch and streaming workloads, similar to how we process the data. So we can collect the data in a streaming fashion and also in a batch fashion. So what is a batch fashion? Let's say you have some application and you are logging everything and you want to collect the logs. So you can either collect these logs as and when the log is produced, or you can make sure that every day at the end of the day you pull the log into some data store for processing. So there are different modes for data collection in general. Like, it can be a pull mechanism or push mechanism. So there are different tools which I am going to discuss further, which will show how the data collection can happen. So the tool can either pull the data as and when it is produced, or you can configure the tool for pushing the data into the data store. So next thing I want to discuss is data ingestion. Anyone knows what is data ingestion? I think if you are using Kafka, so this is what you do normally. So data ingestion is nothing but you are storing the input data in a data store before you start processing the data. So it is normally coupled with your input source, that is your data points, and also as an input for the data processing pipelines. And also data ingestion tools, main functionality is to route the data between your input source and the data processing engine. So this is the diagrammatic view I want to show for what is data collection and what is data ingestion. So typically in any project, this is what we see. So you will have some input data store. So I will talk about what can be the input data store in detail. But let's think this is a just like a repository having all your input data, which you want to process again in the data processing engine. So here Spark sits in the green box, that is data processing engine. Input data store can be a Kafka or it can be other ingestion system. And your data sources can be anything which is emitting the data for your application. So it can be an IoT device or it can be a mobile device which is generating the data points which you want to consume in your application. So this, there is a very thin line between data collection and data ingestion. Also, many people may not follow the same architecture. They directly try to plug to the data source and do that processing. But this is a standardized way of doing any data pipeline. So why it is important? If you see this diagram, so if you see this diagram, let's say these two pieces are going wrong. So what happens in this case? Whatever the best data processing engine you have, and whatever the code you write for processing the data, so if your data is going wrong, whatever the results you produce doesn't make any sense. So it is very important to focus these two pieces before we start data processing. And also, as I said initially, so these are the like, it looks simple if you see what they do, but they're very important for any data pipeline. And if you see like the talks that we have given, we don't really focus much on this part. So today, this will be our main focus. We don't focus much on these two pieces. So we focus more on the data ingestion and how to control the data that you are into your application. So have you used any like data collection tools or data ingestion tools? Anyone can name. You should be loud. Okay. Scoop is there. NiFi, yeah. So I want to focus on a few tools that I picked up. There is no real rule how I picked this up. They are very random. I just want to go through some of them and what they are, where they stand in a data processing pipeline. I think first one I want to talk about is rsyslog. So this is a like ancient data collector, I want to call it, because whenever you have a Unix machine, this is something which will be there in your machine by default. I'm not sure how many of you used it, but this is very useful for knowing what is happening in the system. And it always runs in a streaming mode. That means whatever activity is happening in your system, it tries to log. And it is very useful if you go and read the logs and try to understand, but it is very hard to extend this one. And it is very hard to integrate with this one. So that's why it is always there, but very less people use it. So next tool I want to talk about is Flume. I think everyone might have heard of Flume if you are in big data. So this is a distributed data collection service. Even we have used Flume in one of our application. And it is a solution for data collection of all formats. So it ensures whatever the data is generated will be populated into the data stores reliably without any failures. All those guarantees Flume will guarantee you. And it is initially designed to transfer log data into HDFS frequently. But later on, there are a lot of plugins available today where Flume can integrate with and also pull the data into your ingestion system. So it is written and maintained by Cloudera today. And it is very popular for data collection in Hadoop ecosystem. So next tool I want to focus is Logstash. So how many of you heard of this Logstash? So it is, again, a popular tool in ELK stack. So that is Elastic Stack. So it has a pluggable architecture, and it is very efficient in data collection part. So it follows a very good idea of how the data collection should happen. So the pattern where it shines well in any pipeline is whenever you have data which is generating in various sources and you want to distribute this data to multiple outputs. So that is the mode in which it works very efficiently. And it is written in JRuby. And it has like multiple input and multiple output supports. And this you can think as a centralized logs where you can collect the logs and parse and also store and forward. So parsing can be a bit extensive, like you can have your own rules how your log should look whenever it is collected and whenever you are getting out of logs cache. So next tool I want to focus is Fluentd. So this is also similar to logs cache, but it is very efficient if you have one input plugged into one output. So it has a built-in high availability architecture, and it can also do multi-source and multi-destination routing. But it is, instead of this, logs cache can be very efficient in that mode. But whenever you have the single input plugged into single output, so in that mode, Fluentd will be more efficient. So I think Fluentd is something available in Google Cloud as a service today for its performance. So next I move to the data ingestion piece. So I have only one tool here because the next thing I want to discuss is Kafka, which is our main topic. And so before I start with Kafka, I want to give an introduction of RabbitMQ. So this is very popular in enterprise grade applications. So it follows something called AMQP. So I'm not sure how many of you are aware of this. It follows that standard of message queuing systems. And it also has pluggable architecture and REST APIs to program your application. So it provides strong guarantees for messages. It is very good in a single machine architecture, but it's not a distributed message queue architecture. So now I want to start with Kafka. So how many of you used Kafka? So how comfortable you are with Kafka? So are you using the latest versions of Kafka or you are in still old versions? So since there are very few people who know about Kafka, I want to go through like basic introduction of it, and then I focus on how Kafka integrates with Spark. So Kafka in general is a high throughput, publish, subscribe, message based messaging system. So what it means, there will be publisher and there will be subscribers. So that is a basic idea on which Kafka is built. So publishers are the one who normally generates the data and puts in Kafka. Subscribers are the one who will be consuming the data from Kafka. So why Kafka is so popular? Because of this basic idea. Because they decoupled the binding between publishers and subscribers. So that is what happening in earlier message queuing systems like RabbitMQ or other MQs out there. So there is no real dependency between a publisher and subscriber. So Kafka gives a lot of guarantees following these ideas. So in general, Kafka can be treated as a distributed, partitioned, and replicated commit log. So whenever you see these words, distributed, partitioned, and replicated, so I think RDD also has these properties. So that means whatever the data that you put into Kafka, so will have these properties. So Kafka is by default distributed, so it can run in a cluster mode and it can handle heavy loads. And Kafka, whatever the data you write into Kafka is partitioned by default. So that is the reason why Kafka is very popular. And it is a replicated commit log. So replication is something which ensures failures and failure recovery mechanisms. So similar to how your HDFS operates. So you see the similar properties present for Kafka, whatever the data you write into Kafka. So messages in general are persistent in the Kafka system as topics. So whatever the data you write, it will be treated as a message. And every message you write will be associated to something called as topic. So it is similar to topic can be treated as a a group of or similar messages where all the similar source systems will be putting their data into topics. So you can have multiple sources, right? which will be pushing data into your MQs. So topics is a logical division that you can have for consumption of the data that is produced. And Kafka uses something called Zookeeper for cluster management. So Zookeeper is also again a quite popular tool, distributed service discovery mechanism tool for Hadoop. So Kafka uses this Zookeeper for maintaining its own clusters and cluster health. And Zookeeper, sorry, Kafka is written in Scala, but it also supports a lot of client APIs like Java, Ruby, Python. So it is developed by LinkedIn, but now there is a company behind Kafka that is Confluent, who are very aggressively putting up the new features that I want to discuss later into Kafka. So from the high level, this is how Kafka looks. So the producers are the ones who would be generating the input for your Kafka cluster. So these clusters are, Kafka cluster is nothing but similar to your Spark cluster. So you can have many nodes of Kafka in a Kafka cluster, and all the producers can publish the data to the same cluster. And consumers will be consuming the data from cluster. And there you see that there is no real binding between producer and consumer. Whatever a consumer reads from this Kafka cluster, it is responsible of the consumer to maintain its own track of messages that is read and how it wants to retry on the failures, all that things. So these are basic terminologies if you're working in Kafka, that is. We have brokers, which is nothing but your machines that are part of your Kafka cluster. And producers are the processes. It can be any client. It can be a Java client or Scala client, whatever the API Kafka supports. You can write your own producers so that you can push the data into Kafka. And we have consumers. Again, Kafka gives a lot of variations in the client APIs. You can write your own consumers to consume the data from Kafka. And there is a concept of consumer group. So it is nothing but a set of consumers sharing a common group to consume topic data. So why we need a consumer group? Because as I said, topic can be partitioned. So under high loads, it becomes, in some scenarios, you cannot handle the data, whatever coming into Kafka through a single consumer. So the idea of consumer group tries to solve this. So consumer group is nothing but a set of consumers who will be consuming the data from the same topic. But the mapping between a consumer inside a group to topic is at the partition level. So whatever the consumer inside your consumer group will consume the data from a given partition inside a topic, so that you don't end up having duplicates in your reads. So finally, we have topics. So topics is where messages are maintained and partitioned. So topics has two things, again, to understand. It has partitions. So partitions is similar to your RDD kind of partitions. And there is also something called offset. It is a sequence ID given to each message that is pushed into Kafka. So since a sequence ID is something like, since it has sequence, so Kafka ensures whatever the data that you are writing into a topic will be in a sequence for a given partition. So this is a diagrammatic view, like how a Kafka topic looks. So each topic can have multiple partitions, and each partition, those numbers are nothing but the sequence numbers. Whatever the writes that is happening from the producer side, it will be appended to the partition end. So as I said, it is a distributed commit log. So this is how the writes are happening to the Kafka. And you see here, consumers can start consuming from the starting point, or they can consume from any sequence for a given partition. So that is how consumers and producers are decoupled. So now let's see how Spark and Kafka integrate. So I'm not sure how many of you tried to write your own consumer for Kafka. If you are using Spark, Spark has its own consumers to consume the data from Kafka. So normally people working in Spark doesn't develop their own consumers, but it is good to know about the consumer overall idea, because that is where your all failure recovery, those kind of things stand. Before going into those details, this is how like the compatibility between Spark and Kafka stays today. So we have Spark streaming, so this is nothing but D-streams. So it supports your old Kafka APIs, that is before 0.10, and Spark streaming also supports point after 1.10. But if you see, for the structured streaming, it doesn't support the lower version of Kafka. It supports only from the version 0.10 of Kafka. Why? Because, so these are some of the things which change in the newer versions of Kafka. So there is a lot of changes happening in the Kafka side itself, and it is very hard, you know, Spark to support all the versions. So these are some of the key changes which led to these kind of differences. So between these two versions, there is a lot of changes in the consumer semantics from the Kafka side, and Kafka is keep on changing the message formats, that how you write the data. So because of its own reasons, and there is in the recent version of Kafka, they're reducing the dependency between Kafka and Zookeeper for lot of issues that normally faced by developers with Zookeeper. So nowadays offsets are also stored inside a Kafka topic, and there is a new security features which are adapted into Kafka latest versions, like encryptions and also ACLs. So this is the main reason why you see this differentiation between structured streaming and D-streams, how you integrate to Kafka. So I think we don't discuss about D-streams in this talk, so our main focus is about structured streaming. So if you see, Kafka is something which is very popular as a ingestion source for all the streaming applications that we normally build. Spark started to support Kafka for structured streaming from 2.1. I think, have anyone tried this? Very less. So for I just want to give some semantics how you can integrate with Kafka. So you just have to provide these three parameters whenever you connect to Kafka. So you provide the broker IPs and topics and partitions, so if you want, and whatever whenever you read some data from Kafka, so this will be your input schema. So by default you have key and value, so that is your data which is coming from Kafka. And you also have something called topic name and which partition you are reading that particular message, and also offset of that particular message in a topic. And you also have something called timestamp. So I'll be going to discuss about this timestamp. So at the high level, you can think this timestamp as the ingestion timestamp. So it will be plugged into your message whenever the message is written into Kafka broker. So I think any doubts till now before I start examples? Which one? Yes, yes, we have examples.
Like the data integrity is being handled by Kafka. Like for example, they are sending in 10 messages, and all 10 are getting delivered right on the producer.
Yes, yes. So that is something Spark ensures. So Spark ensures whatever the data written into Kafka will be consumed exactly once. So there are two failures which can happen. So failure can happen at the producer end, like you produce some data and you want to write it to Kafka, a failure can happen at that side. So that should be handled in the Kafka side. But if you want to handle the failures from the time you read data from Kafka into Spark, so that is something Spark handles. So any more doubts? So we can start with our example. I think you have to go to Kafka .com. So this is a very basic program where I'm reading data from Kafka and just generating the word counts. I have some data in my topic which is a string. I just want to do the word count. So if you see the way we integrate with Kafka and structure streams, so it is very easy. You just have to change the format to Kafka and you provide the parameters in option. So this is very similar to how you integrate in normal data frames. So for Kafka is like a first class data source for Spark now. So you just have to provide where is your Kafka server is located and what is the topic, and there is something called starting offsets. I will talk more about this in next example. So earliest just think it denotes you are consuming the data from beginning of the topic. And if you see how I am parsing this data, since I showed the schema of the input, you have key and you have value and also topic, partition and timestamp. So I'm just taking key and value from the input columns. So since key and value by default, they will be in a binary format, we just have to cast them to string and then start consuming inside the application. So it is not necessary you have to take key always, it depends on your program. Here if you see, I'm taking key and value and then I'm mapping only the second column and doing normal word count. So I think we can run this. Before running, we have to start Kafka server. You have to start Zookeeper first. Yeah. Consumer? It is coming up. Just dot slash start Kafka. So I just started my Kafka local server. So let's run this program and see what we get. So can you go up a bit? So you see, like we are producing the results in the same fashion as a data frame. So you have two columns in the output, value and the count, and it's just word counts that we populated. So it is very easy to consume any data from Kafka. You just have to provide three parameters and start consuming the data inside streaming application. So next we move on to the next example. Let's see in slide what we have. So I want to show this ingestion time word count. So this is something very specific to structured streams. And ingestion time normally denotes the time of the data when it is written into Kafka. So you can do analysis based on the time, like the ingestion time inside structured streaming. Okay, so I'm doing the same thing to connect to Kafka, but instead of key and values, I'm just taking value and I'm casting the timestamp as long and then I'm doing some formatting. So if you see these cast are from Unix time, so these are all normal Spark UDFs, how we write for data frames. So you can directly write them and consume the data from Kafka. So since timestamp is already available in your input stream that you are reading from Kafka, so you just have to make sure you are formatting and doing the word count based on that field. So if you see, after this I am populating word and the timestamp in the data frame. So finally I am creating a window of 30 seconds for the word count. Finally I am just printing into the console. So I want to show you like how this ingestion time works. I think we have shown this in our last session also, but this is with respect to ingestion times and with Kafka. So let's run this one. So currently we have four windows, and that is a word count, like how many words are present in that particular window. Go back to console and let's add some data to the topic. There is a tab already, the other one, yeah. So just go to before. So this is one file. I am writing this data into the Kafka through console producer. So this is how we can write data through the console. We just have to use console producer script. And we have to provide the Kafka broker and what topic we want to add. So here I am taking the input of a file and just writing to the topic. So let's write this and see in our program what happens. So you see, as and when the data is added to topic, structure stream ensures your new batch is triggered. So we have a new window now, that is 10:45:30. So let's add one more data. Yeah, I think we missed. So we just have to ensure we put the data in the 30 seconds window. So I think it went to 46. So you see, in the last batch, we got a window for 10:46 for two, that is two words. So, but in the next batch, the same window is getting updated based on the ingestion time that is coming from Kafka. So, this is a way to work with ingestion time with respect to Kafka. So, any doubts in this? Okay. You can go back to slides. Yeah. So, next topic I want to discuss is about offsets. So there are three variations how you consume data from Kafka topics based on the offsets. So these are the three things which can be possible. One is earliest, so that we have used in our program already. So earliest means you are consuming the data from starting of the topic. So next we have something called assigned. So assigned takes particular offsets where you want to start consuming from the topic. So you can give, for this partition, I want to start consuming from this sequence ID. And for the topic one, I want to consume from K. So this one we can track manually to record the progress of your application and also for recovery. And that is how Spark also works in the failures. And there is something called latest. So latest means it will start consuming the data after your query is started. So that means you start the program, it will not do anything because it is the latest. You have to add data to the Kafka after starting your query. So then only this one start consuming the data from Kafka. So I think we have seen earliest. So latest is also similar. You just have to specify starting offsets as latest. We'll see the assigned one. So you see here now, for the starting offsets, I have given the topic, and also this is like 0 is the partition number I'm consuming, and 5 is the offset. So it will start consume from the fifth sequence ID in your partition 0 of word count topic. So let's run this. So we can't really differentiate because there is a lot of words, but we just have to close this results. So we just have to make sure we provide proper offsets here to consume based on your application logic. So go back. Yeah.
Is it done practically? Like,
which one?
I mean, you will have given absolute ID from this ID.
Yes, yes. Normally, this will be taken care by Spark, but if you want to do your own offset tracking mechanism kind of thing in your application, so you can normally store the offsets that you have already consumed in some, you know, can be stored in a file or external database, and then you can read from there and start processing for the failures.
Spark?
Yes, yes. Yes.
When you have a Spark with multiple workers, how does the partition get assigned to different workers?
So each worker is assigned to one partition.
There can be more than number of partitions can be more than number of Spark workers.
Number of partitions can be more than
number of Spark workers.
Yes.
How
would, so normally Spark makes sure that you have equal number. If it is a mismatch, so there can be delays, but also Spark tries to this increase the read threads. So where that what we call tasks are more for each partition, normally a how can I say?
So let's say you have 10 partitions.
Yes.
And 2 Spark workers, or let's say 3 Spark workers. So someone will have to assign that these many partitions are going to these specific.
No, Spark will ensure. Yeah.
Spark will do that assignment.
Yes. 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 Yeah.
The Spark will take care that those partitions are
moved. Yeah, move to the next worker. Yeah. Yes.
Suppose I start processing consuming from the Spark side. I am consuming as an RDS. Now, if I process any particular data, even though an exception happened, and I want to handle it in a different way. So, in that code logic, when I am going to start consuming from the value side, how I can get what actual offset value?
Okay. So go back to slides. Go to the before where we had schema. So this is a schema for your each record that you are consuming. So it will have offset. So you have to track this. No, this is your input inside your Spark.
This is my Spark side. Okay.
Yes.
This is the overall number of Spark.
No, this is the offset for this particular record. Not really. Actually, with Spark, structure streaming, consumer groups are automatically generated by Spark. Yeah. Yes. So actually, we used to do this a lot in B streams, but with structure stream, it's pretty straightforward because you have this offset here in the input, and also structure streaming has a lot of callbacks for each query that you are running. So you can register the callbacks for the queries and make sure what are the offsets which are already processed. So you don't have to write back to Kafka, you can write to database only. Yes, yes. Yes. What
kind of format you are using here? Is it binary, JSON, or
Airbus? So it is a binary. So it is actually a string, but when we consume from Kafka, it will be in binary format.
Yeah, the menu here, the data of Kafka, JSON data in Kafka.
Yes.
But, so in your example, you have translated a string. You know that it's a string.
Yeah.
What if you don't know the schema of Kafka data? So is there any way I could infer it by another string?
Currently, there is no built-in inference. But if you know schema, you can plug the schema for this column and pass. But I think there is a new feature coming up for Avro formats. So Spark will automatically determine the schema from the Avro data that is there.
Data in the
Kafka
is mostly JSON.
So you can treat it like a normal JSON string and then do this passing stuff.
On my own.
Yeah.
For Kafka, so we have something like KSQL, right?
Yeah.
So, stream the process, data, and yeah. So, what will be Spark specifically for that? You can do that.
You mean Kafka streams?
Yes, Kafka streams.
Yeah, yeah. You can do that. It depends on your use case.
So, how you can ask this Microsoft? So, when we look at the user upgrades you are running, so then how does the process run?
But in a production system, we don't normally do that because the cluster is already running. So when you do query.stat, it will make sure like it will keep on generating new batches whenever there is.
You know that like for this case for streaming purpose, mainly there will be cases wherein they will be scheduling this program.
Yeah.
But once we are taking it.
So normally we don't do that avoid termination in a production system.
Then the process of this won't be sold, right?
No. No, that is left to Spark to make sure whenever new data comes, it will trigger new batches to process. So avoid termination is only to make sure like in our IDE it will kill itself, right? For, since we are running in a main thread. No. So any more questions? Okay. So next thing I want to discuss about checkpointing and write-ahead logs. So these two concepts are quite similar how it used to work in these streams. So your structured streaming also supports. I should have some. So structured streaming also has this checkpointing idea. It doesn't apply only for Kafka, but all the streams that you are reading. And write-ahead logs still exist for same purpose how it used to work in these streams. And checkpointing with the structured streaming normally tracks progress of the query. And it often keep writing intermediate state to the file system. So intermediate state here is about your streaming query states and also the offsets that is consumed in your application. And for Kafka, offset range and data process in each trigger are the things which are tracked by checkpointing. And checkpointing we normally write for as an option for writers. So that I will show in my example. And you can, one thing which is interesting with structured streaming is you can modify the application and also restart from the same checkpoint. So this is something which DStream was not able to support. So with the structured streams, you can stop the query and modify your code and restart from the same checkpoint. The state everything will start from the same checkpoint. So we'll see this example how it works. So everything remains same, only thing I have here is checkpoint location. So here I am specifying This will be my checkpoint location where I'm tracking the progress of the query. See whether it is already there. No, it will be in the resources only. Okay. So we can run this one. So first batch completed. Let's see what gets written into checkpointing folder. No, no, main you close and open. Main folder, yeah. Yes. Go to offsets. Yeah. So this is how like Spark internally tracks what are the offsets consumed and which batch it has consumed. And if you restart this application, let's stop and start again. So you see, there is no batch getting generated because all the data it is already processed and Spark is tracking it. So let's go back to program. In the last line, you change that map groups. Comment out the last line and uncomment the. Yeah. So restart the program now. So what I did, I changed the code and I want to consume from the same checkpoint again for the new data. So let's go and add some data here. Yeah. So you see, it used to produce that. So it is now doing that size of your counts. So earlier it used to just print 10 for all the results. Okay. So let's go back to slides. We can use persistent storage, but we can also use this. So we can store this in S3. So checkpoint can be your S3 location. So even if you are not close down, you can always consume this.
See some venture persistency issue.
Yeah, that will be good. So next thing is Kafka sync. So this is a new feature in structured streaming. So till now, okay.
Only checkpoint. So the night checkpoint will always be there, like checkpoint will always be there. When you are running any new program, we are pointing there.
Yeah. Next. The topic is Kafka sync. So this is something, a new feature for structured streaming. So earlier we used to write our own writers to write the data from Spark application to Kafka. But structured streaming in the latest version from 2.2, so you can directly write to Kafka from the Spark itself. And it currently it supports at least one semantics. So that is something Spark is improving in the latest version. And also to achieve the exactly one semantics, normally the current practice is to ensure you are reading the data again with some deduplication logic. So this will go away, I think, in the next versions of Spark, because there is something exactly one semantics is supported by Kafka now. So Spark is improving on that side. So let's see how we can write or data to Kafka sync. Yes. Before running this, just go to console and open a consumer. In the next tab, there is a consumer. Yeah. So this is a topic I'm consuming. Currently, it has printed whatever the data we have. So let's run our program. We should see some new data which we are producing from the program. So we see like the new data we are directly writing to Kafka from Spark. So this is how it's very easy. Go back to the program. Come down. So you just have to give again it's the same format, and you have to specify the output modes. So these are similar output modes for any streaming query, and you specify your Kafka brokers and topics. Yeah, normally checkpoint location will be in the sync side.
So it is as good as like we are generating certain output and storing to it.
Yes. Yeah. So go back to slides. So Kafka sync also supports update mode. This is like a update mode of your streaming query. So I have an example, but it is very similar. You just get the new updates for your Kafka. Go to program. We don't need to run this. Maybe. So in the end, for the results, you can specify update mode and append mode, and also complete mode for Kafka syncs based on your aggregations. Go back to slides. Yeah, but it actually appends the new data topic. It doesn't update actually. It will update the new message actually. So that is the only variation.
It reads the latest one.
Yeah. So next, I want to show how you can treat Kafka as a normal data source. So you can create, you know, batch data frames from Kafka in the new Spark version. Let's see this, how the semantics look. Go to examples. So I have two variations here. I want to explain this one first. We'll go back to the other one. So you can consume data from multiple topics for your data frames. And there are two variations how you can consume. So if you don't specify these two, like here, it will start consuming from your earliest offsets from the topic. Or you can also specify what are the offsets should be considered for data consumption. So you can specify two things here, starting offsets and ending offsets. And you have to provide the offsets for each topic that you want to consume. So let's see how the output looks for this. So you see here, we consume data from multiple topics. And for every topic, it will also give you the offsets that it has consumed. So this is just to demonstrate how you can consume, and you see this is normal data frame that you are creating from Kafka. So this is a new feature again in 2.2. Okay, we can go back to slides. So any doubts till now? Next topics are about delivery semantics before I start. So offsets will be for your Kafka data, but you can track them from the Spark side. Yeah. Mm-hmm. No, when you consume data from Spark, so Spark will not create two tasks for consuming from same partition. So it will always be one reader for one partition. So we saw basics of how Spark structure streaming supports Kafka and what are the new things that you can do with Kafka and Spark. And next topic is all about delivery semantics. So this is something which is very important for any application. Because till now, like up to 0.10, Kafka used to support at least one semantics. But in the recent version, they started supporting exactly once. So I want to give a little bit of details about how this integration is happening and what are the new things in Kafka and what will be coming in Spark. So in general, for delivery semantics, it ensures how your results or how your input will be treated inside the application and what are the guarantees that your framework gives. So normally we see three variations in these semantics. So first thing is at least one semantics. So what happens here is your results, whatever the results you populate will be delivered at least once. So that is a guarantee your framework is giving for your application. So what it means at the end of the day, there are chances of having duplicates in your results. So this is the current state of Spark Kafka sync, as I said earlier. So the next variation is at most once. So your framework will ensure the results will not be duplicated, but there can be a chances of results will go missing. And the third one is very important, that is exactly once. So you are reading the data as and when it is produced, and your framework ensures all the results will correspond to the input data exactly once. So there will not be duplicates or there will not be any missing candidates in the results. So this is the basic variations what we see in different frameworks. So because in a big data application, we can have multiple frameworks. So here itself we have Spark and Kafka. So let's say you have some NoSQL database again. You want to write to the NoSQL database all your results. So these are the semantics which matters a lot for your application. So let's see what Spark delivery semantics looks like at present. So Spark can guarantee exactly one semantics, but based on your input source and output source. So because Spark supports a lot of input sources, and you can write results from Spark to a lot of output sources. So Spark depends on these two pieces to give guarantees for your results. So for the input source, Spark requires a source should be a replayable source. So that means whenever a failure happens, Spark should be able to go back to the input source and ask for the repeated data for reconsumption because Spark has lost its results. So that is something input source should provide in its side so that Spark can guarantee this kind of semantics. And in the output store, your output store should be intelligent enough to detect the duplicates that Spark produces. So that means your output store should be of type idempotent sync. So that means even if Spark writes same result again, your store should detect that and it makes sure that the result is not duplicated. So these are some of the properties that your input and output stores should give to Spark. Then only Spark will ensure the exactly one semantics. So as I said, it depends on type of sources and syncs. So together with using replayable sources and idempotent syncs, structure streaming can ensure end-to-end exactly one semantics. So because in the newer Spark versions, so they have something called transactional writes, so which is only for the structure streaming and new version of Spark. So using these two properties and the new features of Spark, Spark can ensure exactly one semantics based on these features. And currently Spark supports exactly one semantics for file output sync. So you see like Kafka is missing here. So that is something which is in the future. So I have taken the, this is actually image from the official documentation. It shows like what is the current state of different syncs in Spark. So we have file sync, Kafka sync, for each sync, and console and memory are normally for development purpose. So if you see file sync, it is fault tolerant and it says it supports exactly once as of today. But if you see the output modes, it supports only up and output mode. So you cannot have complete or updates in your streaming queries when you are using file syncs. For the Kafka, it supports all the modes. But if you see, it guarantees at least once semantics. So this is what I want to focus on. So next we have for each, that completely depends on how you implement the for each writers for your output stores. Go next. For each sync is like your RDD.forEach. So you have to implement your own way how the for each function should look like for your output store. For each of the records, how you want to store in your output, what will be your output, all that stuff. So it is not like, let's say for Kafka, it is understood that your results should be going to Kafka. For foreach, it is your custom implementation. You can store to MySQL or you can store to any database or files, whatever you want. The complete mode is actually query output mode. It provides results from the beginning of the query, always. So go next. So I want to show this file sync example. So I'm not doing much inside this program. I just have these two options, checkpoint location and path. So let's run this and see how Spark tracks internally. So we have got our first batch output. Let's go to that path, output path. No, output. So if you see, there is a folder called Spark metadata. Open that. So it tracks all the details of the outputs that is written for that particular query. So you see, it tracks what is the file written, and what is it, and what is its modification time. And it is also called action that is add. So this shows why file sync is only in append mode. And even if you write new data, let's add some data to the topic. So you see, whatever the new results that we are producing, it goes to new output files. And if you see the old file, it will have the earlier results. And each files are tracked inside that metadata folder for this exactly once guarantees. Go back to slides. So that completes my all the examples. So any doubts before I, this is just a what is the new features and what Kafka is offering in the latest versions? I just want to discuss a bit about it. Okay. So in the latest version of Kafka, as I said, Kafka currently supports exactly one semantics. So how Kafka supports this semantics is by these three features. So there is something called idempotent producer from Kafka, which ensures there will not be any duplicates in the Kafka input itself. So because in the earlier versions of Kafka, there can be a chance of getting duplicates inside the Kafka itself because of this feature. And there is something called a transactional producer, which will ensure the atomic writes across multiple partitions. I'll go detail about each of these next. And there is also something called exactly once stream processing. So this is something like currently Kafka stream supports. This is called as read process write commit pattern. I'll go more detail about this. So let's see what used to happen in Kafka earlier and what happens today. So earlier Kafka used to give at least once guarantees because this is how it used to work. We have a producer and you are writing some data to the Kafka broker. So the broker will append the data to your topic and it will acknowledge the producer. So let's say your acknowledgement is lost and producer thinks the data is not appended, it will resend the message. Since there is no way for the broker to detect it is a duplicate, it will go back and append the same data again. It will send the new acknowledgement. So this was the scenario in the earlier versions of Kafka. So let's see how it looks like now. So in the message that you are sending, Kafka added more metadata about sequence and the producer ID. So based on this, even if producer sends the same message again, broker is intelligent enough now to detect it as a duplicate and it will send the previous acknowledgement. So this ensures in the Kafka side, there will not be any duplicates in your input. And to enable this from the Kafka side, you have to use the latest version. And this is a property which enables this mode in Kafka. So that is enable idempotence equal to true. So next, there is a concept of multi-partition writes in Kafka. So single producer can write to multiple partitions. So whenever there is a group of writes a producer wants to do, it can do across the partitions and it can commit in a single transaction. So there will be a new message of commit for each partition that the producer is writing. So this is again a new thing in Kafka. So for doing this, every transaction has its own unique ID inside Kafka to track these commits. So let's see how it looks from the consumer side. So from the consumer side, you can specify consumer should read always the committed data. So even if some duplicates or whatever written after this commit, so consumer is intelligent enough to neglect those messages and it will read only the messages which are committed. So that will ensure a consumer to read all the committed messages and it will discard the other messages. So this is the, again, property inside Kafka to make sure your consumer will be consuming the committed messages. So the last thing is exactly once stream processing. So this is how, in general, how it looks. You can begin the transactions inside Kafka and you can send multiple records and you can send offset for this transaction and you also commit this transaction. So one thing you want to notice here is you are sending offsets from the producer. So this is something Spark lacks today. So what it means, let's say you have an input as Kafka and your output as Kafka. So there will be a producer for your output, right? So that producer will track the offsets, whatever it is written in your batch, and it will make sure all those offsets are committed back to Kafka. So this is something which is coming up in the latest version of Spark. So this pattern we call as read process, write, and then commit the offsets back to Kafka. Yes, as of today it won't associate, but this will ensure that your input and processing and writing back to Kafka happening at one shot. So that is something coming in the future. Which one? This is actually a normal transaction and it depends on how Spark is implementing it. So this is like a basic producer side transaction you can have in your normal program. So this is not really a Spark mode actually. Which one? Yeah, this is a Kafka side batching, but it depends how Spark will be implementing it. That is not there today. So what is coming in the future? Spark will be providing this new semantics that is available in Kafka today. So that all the new three things what I discussed, they are absent in Spark today. So there are these are the few Jiras where you can track this progress. And also Kafka is moving in a direction where these idempotent producer behavior will be a default behavior in the latest versions. And there is also something called structure streaming continuous mode. I think this is already released in the latest release, that is 2.3, which happened this week. So these are some of the references. You can go through them. We'll publish the slides in our Meetup group. So finally, I want to introduce myself. So I'm Shashidhar. I'm working as a lead solution engineer at Databricks. So I intentionally kept this slide in the end because Databricks is hiring in India. So if you are interested, you can post your resumes to my mail ID. That's it from my side if you don't have any questions.